I met an 11 or 10 year old girl, actually, she's almost 11, for the first time. And but what you don't know is I met her for her to become part of our family. Actually flew to Taiwan, was in Taiwan several weeks in order to do all the paperwork and do all the things that we needed to do through the Taiwan government. And Jenna has been part of our family now this week for 11 years. And it's awesome. So, and I have a picture of her little, but I don't think, hang on, I'm going to be, see, we have internet here, so I can like ruin your life. All right, so I'm going to see if I can show you, even though it won't be on the screen, forgive me. Eventually, now that would be cool. I need to get like Apple TV so Dave can just switch it over. And oh, I hadn't uploaded yet. Okay,
never mind.
ADD moment for you. Brought to you by, we need to have ADD moment brought to you by, you know, whatever, have an advertisement, yeah. Ritalin's good for that. Yeah. And then just yesterday, Jenna got bought her own car.
Yay!
And, yeah. Which is good because she wrecked the other one. Anyway, so. I know, I'm such a great dad. But I was thinking back, you know, today we're going to talk about this idea of your mission, and I remember seeing Jenna's picture for the first time, and all the things that needed to be done, and all the paperwork that has to be done to adopt a child. And by the way, for those of you who want to ask, I'll answer, we did try to adopt through the state of Florida, and the state of Florida was not very helpful to us adopting in the state of Florida. It was actually easier at that time to adopt from Taiwan, for those of you who might ask that question. And hopefully that's changed and it's not the same anymore. But anyway, so as we dealt with all the paperwork from Taiwan, as we went through this process and took classes and all of these things, there were all these things that had to take place in order for the goal of adopting Jenna, who now is Jenna Brookings. And so as I was thinking about the wise men, I thought, and I'm going to probably dispel a lot of your thoughts about wise men by the time we're done and ruin your nativity scene, and it's really going to be great. But but here's the deal. The one thing, in the Old Testament, there's a set of scriptures where they found the scripture, and it says they read them to the people, and then they helped them to apply it. So every week, that's what I want to do. I want to look at scripture and then say, okay, so what do we do with what we know? Because a lot of times we read about the wise men and we're like, yeah, that was really good. Some guys visited Jesus and that's awesome. But we don't know what that has to do with us. So today I'm going to talk about a few things that maybe you never noticed in the story that apply to you and apply to me. And so we're going to talk about six ways the wise men discovered their mission and questions in order for you to accomplish your mission. So, you know, we all love the wise men. You know, nobody says, I love the wise men. I mean, that's a sentence I've never heard. Anybody ever heard that sentence? Not a sentence you hear. So we love that story. We love to hear about the three gifts. And here's the thing. For us, it's easy for us to miss our mission. We get distracted, as you've noticed this morning already, right? We need help. Sometimes we fail. Sometimes we even forget to seek God about what he wants us to do. And so here's what I want you to know today. God has a mission for you. The simple version of your mission is love God and love people. That's your mission if you're a Christian. But in that, you know, how do I accomplish that? What do I do day by day? What do I do with the gifts God's given me? How do I use that? And so we're going to look at just a few things that kind of give you that overall idea to help you to hone in on, obviously, you know, loving God and loving people is your mission, but then what do you do with that? So, number one, here's what I know about the wise men. God's word gave them direction. Many scholars believe that these were wise men from Babylon, which would have been maybe even some of the guys who the Bible and information about the Bible and even parts of Scripture were passed down to them by Daniel. And I don't know if you remember the story of Daniel and exile and that whole deal, but they actually believe that these guys learned about the future Messiah from Daniel. And here's what it said in the Old Testament in Micah, which they actually come to rely on Scripture again in a minute. But here's what it says in the Old Testament. But you, Bethlehem, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from old, talking about eternal, right? He will stand, a few verses later, and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord, his God, and they will live securely, for then his greatness will reach to the ends of the earth. Now, Matthew uses this same verse and basically summarizes it when he's talking later, and we'll see that in just a minute. So in the Old Testament, there was a king prophesied, there was a Messiah prophesied, and in the Old Testament, it's interesting because Matthew sets out to prove that Jesus was king and that he was the Messiah. And one of the things it talks about in Scripture, if you look at the Old Testament, it talked about the Messiah or Jesus being from Bethlehem, Egypt. Talked about, I don't know if it's pronounced Ramah or Rama, and then also Nazareth. And how does that happen? And so, of course, we know now, and Matthew explained it to us, how Jesus was born in Bethlehem, how he fled to Egypt. Ramah actually was any high place. Bethlehem was actually sometimes called that. In Jeremiah 31:15, it talks about the weeping there. And then, of course, we know about Nazareth as he did his ministry. And so, as we look at these different things and we see the prophecy, the wise men were aware of the prophecies of Jesus. They were looking. They knew what to look for because they had read God's Word. So let me ask you a question today about you. Do you spend time in God's Word? See, we spend time on so many things. We spend time on Facebook and Snapchat and Instagram. And some of you still have an account with MySpace. Anybody still have an account with MySpace? I just want to see those hands. Are you confessing your sins? So if you have stock in MySpace and you haven't sold it yet, you're really out of luck. I just want to say that now. Yeah, it was you. You were the one. So when you spend time in God's Word, here's what you discover. You learn about Scripture. Did you know that you don't have to learn everything by experience? Now some of you, like me, are a little dumb. Okay, you maybe got a little ADD, and so you're actually the one who touched the stove, even though your mother told you not to. I was a stove toucher. Can the fellow stove touchers in this room please show me? Now, I gotta ask this. How many of you had to touch it more than once? I just want to see that. See those hands, my people. I'm really sorry. But here's the deal. As you read Scripture and you learn about people and how they obeyed God, or sometimes how they didn't obey God, or how they made dumb choices, or how they made wise choices, you can actually learn in Scripture from even if you did not believe the Bible, even if you did not believe in Jesus, you can learn about living by looking at the examples of others. You don't have to do everything in order to learn. As a believer, when you look at those stories and you realize how the entirety of Scripture is pointing towards the Jesus coming and forgiving us, and that whole idea that sin had to be paid for and how he paid our debt, it's more than just a book. I mean, we seek wisdom in Scripture, and there's advice in Scripture, and there's wonderful things about God's character in Scripture, but what does it do? As we learn about God's character, what happens? We begin to discover who God is and how we can know him. So that we begin to understand that we don't have an unpleasable God. We have a God that sent Jesus to us. We didn't go to him. Christianity is the only religion where God came to you, and that's what we celebrate at Christmas. You know, every once in a while somebody says, I don't know why Christmas is such a big deal. That's why it's a big deal. God sent Jesus to us for us to know him, not the other way around. You don't earn your way to God. He came to you, and the Bible says, to give you and I a free gift. Do you spend time in God's Word? If you don't make any other commitment today and you want to nap after this part of the sermon, if you'll begin spending time in God's Word. Now we have daily bread up back, the little devotion that goes along with your Scripture. It'll help you to just have a little devotion every day. 5 or 6 minutes every day. There's apps on the phone. You can even sign on while you're here today. You get on Surfside Guest, and you type in the word boundaries, and that'll let you on our internet, which is pretty quick, and you can download a Bible while you're sitting in church. I mean, that's the society we live in. We have more access than ever before to God's word. Number two, not only did God's word give them direction, number two, they were paying attention in the moment. What? They were paying attention in the moment. Now, I drove once again in Orlando yesterday on I-4. I know. Can I tell you something I'm noticing? And it doesn't just happen in Orlando, but people don't pay attention. Let me just throw this out for people. When you're driving, drive. That's it. And buckle up, people. Buckle up. If you're too strong to buckle up, just buckle up. I don't want to say much more about that. But do. I don't want you to get to heaven and the angel goes, "What are you doing here early?" Like, "Yeah, I thought I was strong." Yeah, you are. So Matthew 2:2 says this: After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem. Now you'll notice the word "after" there. We're going to talk about this in a minute, but let me talk about us first. These wise men were looking. They were paying attention. They were aware of the past. And they were aware of the future, but they were paying attention in the moment. And I love that movie, by the way, The Gift of the Magi. They actually kind of have this neat, I don't know if this is the way they did it, but it looks cool. They have like a pool, and maybe some scholar can tell me, they had a pool they were looking into to look at the stars as a reflection. I'm not sure if that was clearer or if it was just made up because it looked cool, but it looked really cool in the movie, I gotta say. But they were paying attention to the stars, and it's neat because they show how it wasn't like they just showed up. They had things to do. They had a journey to take. They had to accomplish it. They had to look for the signs of the star, and they had to travel. And so even though they were aware of the past, they didn't live there. Hey, are you? So let me throw a few things out about the wise men just so you know. This is going to really mess up your... Do you have one of these... They see on TV. You have one of these. Now, if you come to my house, my mother owned a kiln for a long time and actually did ceramics and then gave that to my aunt and actually did ceramics for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people over the years. But my mom actually made the nativity set that I have sitting on the china hutch. And it's got, you know, shepherds, camels and sheep and three wise men, and it's wrong, but it's okay. So after I tell you this, I don't want you to drive by churches and like when we put our little nativity out, I don't want you to come and kick the shepherds or move them. I don't want you to show up and say heresy when you show up at people's house, okay? Because it's all part of the same story, but here's what I want you to know. Jesus, and we see this later, was probably, well, he was at least a year old, most theologians think, some think up to three, year and a half, depends how you do the time. So that'll mess you up. It may have not just been three, there might have been 30. We know there were three gifts, but that didn't mean there were three wise men. Different traditions say there were six, and all kinds. We don't know. You know why we don't know? It doesn't matter. Now this is really going to throw you off. Most likely, even the shepherds, Jesus was probably not born December 25th. I know that'll mess you up. Does it matter? No. Do we celebrate December 25th? Absolutely. That's fine. God's outside of time anyway. I think it's okay. But just so you know, now it could have been December 25th. Maybe it was a warm winter. The truth is, we actually started celebrating Christmas at the time we did because it was a Roman holiday and the Christians got off, and instead of worshiping the Roman gods, they worshiped God. Pagans brought trees inside for their worship. Christians brought trees inside and added candles, which, by the way, we're not doing candles on the tree. Somebody said, "Well, Eric, why would we do that pagan symbol of a Christmas tree?" I said, "Because God invented it first. They stole it. We just stole it back." I mean, if you're struggling with pagan worship, you're going to have to rename every month of the year. I'm just saying. The candles representing the life of Christ. So the idea when you look at a nativity is not that the timing is right. The shepherds were later, if you look. He was in a home. And so there's all kinds of things that show us that the wise men came later, the shepherds came earlier, the wise men came later, the shepherds were first, the wise men came later, but it's okay to have them all in the same scene. Because the point is still the same. They came to worship Jesus, and they had a mission, and they accomplished it. But one of the reasons they accomplished it is because they lived in the moment. And let me ask you this question. Do you pay attention in the moment or focus on the past or the future? Some of you, when we had the time of greeting this morning and you had to greet people, you greeted people, but you weren't even thinking about what you were saying. You weren't even looking at the people. Maybe if you looked at them, your brain was somewhere else. You were thinking, do I have fresh breath? Maybe you were thinking, did I brush my teeth? I mean, well, I don't know what you were thinking, but we live our lives that way. When even in the middle of greeting people, we're somewhere else so often. Anybody else distracted like I am? I think of food way too often. I'm just on that. So I want you to go no further today, and don't make this awkward, okay? But take a moment just to say hi to the people next to you real quick. Just say good morning. Just real quick, go ahead. But mean it. Now, the Bible has many things that help you to not live, that help you to live in the moment. Okay? Forgiveness and unforgiveness make you live in the past. So you need to ask forgiveness and you need to give forgiveness in order to live in the present. You can't keep looking back at what somebody did to you and live in the now. You will be miserable. You can't continue to be mad at somebody who hurt you years ago that may not even be alive anymore, okay? And I did a sermon on forgiveness not that long ago, but the truth is, if you are walking around with unforgiveness where you can't forgive you, or you haven't asked somebody to forgive you that you know you need to, you will find yourself in the past. And if you worry all the time and you don't trust God with your future, you won't live in the present. Being a Christian is awesome because, listen, you know what the worst thing that could happen to me is? Today I die suddenly. You know what the best thing that could happen to me is? Today I die suddenly. Now, everybody else, I hope you'll be sad. Some of you might rejoice, Clemson fans. But other than that, right? So I don't have to worry about the future because I know God's got it. That's okay. I lost a friend who was my age and much healthier than me. He visited me in the hospital thinking I was going to die, and last week, car accident, gone. Now, I grieve for his family. The Bible says we grieve, but we don't grieve as we have no hope. So I don't have to go through life going, oh, look out. I mean, if you see me drive, you know I don't do that. It's bad. Do you pay attention in this moment? Because this moment's the one you got. And God wants you to pay attention in the moment. If you're going to accomplish what God wants you to accomplish, you've got to live in the now. You can't live in the next. So we have to forgive. We have to trust God. So they looked at God's word for direction. They were paying attention in the moment. Number three, they asked questions and sought wisdom. We have more information than ever before. We have very little wisdom. There is a big difference between wisdom and information. Anybody can Google what I say on Sunday and correct me. Congratulations, you have Wikipedia. I'm proud of you. When I teach seminary, it gets to be funny because I'll say something that's a little controversial and I'll get students to come up and go, hey, you know, it says this. I'm like, I know, I looked it up before you did. But thanks for the Wikipedia explanation, right? It's hard to be a doctor today. Why? Because everybody comes in and goes, I think I have cancer. No, you have a sore throat. Oh, but I'm dying. You should see what it says on Wikipedia. I'm like, yeah. Right? And so we have all this information, but we don't have wisdom. How do you get wisdom? You have to let it soak in. You have to seek others. Listen to what it says. They asked as they showed up, where is the one who's been born king of the Jews? Which, by the way, Herod did not like this comment. And here's why. Herod called himself the king of the Jews. Did you know that? Other Roman rulers called Herod king of the Jews. That was his title. He was called King of the Jews. He, years before, they had wiped out all the priests, killed them, because it was a rebellion. So they killed them. They got new priests, like, you know, like, hey, you want to be a priest? Sure. Yeah. And so you, these were yes men now, guarantee it. And but he built a new temple, and then he put a Roman eagle on top of the temple, which is actually prophesied in the Old Testament. That's another story. But he put the eagle on there. He let them have their own coins, but then they taxed them for not using Roman coins. Awesome. That's so governmental. But he thought he was king of the Jews. So these guys come and they say, where is the one who's been born king of the Jews? And he's like, whoa, okay, you were doing good until you got to the born part. I'm the one who's king of the Jews. No, the born king of the Jews. You know, the baby. Where's the baby? Well, so you're not talking about somebody who's going to take over now? No, baby. We saw a star when it rose and we've come to worship him. When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed. And by the way, the word for disturbed here is much stronger than just bothered. It's like freaked out in a rage, which is never good for a guy who was horrible and killed people, a lot of people, like at any time. The rulers back then, nobody questioned them at all. It didn't matter what they did. They were considered gods, so they could just wipe you out. What were you going to say? You don't question the gods. So it says he was disturbed, and what happened? All of Jerusalem with him. So word spread quick that the wise men were here. When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, all of Jerusalem with him. When he called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them, where's the Messiah to be born? And then they referred back to that scripture we looked at earlier. In Bethlehem in Judea, they replied, for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people, Israel. You know one of the things that made them wise men? They didn't mind asking others for help. When's the last time that you really asked somebody for help? For their opinion? And you really cared what their opinion was? When's the last time you asked somebody to help you and you didn't feel like you were superior to them? If you want to grow and be able to accomplish the mission God has for you, you have to be willing to allow other people to pour into your life. You have to be willing to listen to others. You can't be so arrogant that you think you have everything together. When's the last time that you were able to listen to somebody, to take in any advice? You know, maybe it's in a small group. Maybe it's a ministry team. Maybe it's just some Christian friends. Maybe it's just somebody you're asking questions of. Maybe it's things you're looking up and discovering in Scripture. Take time to be learning. Take time to grow in wisdom. Take time to listen to those who've gone before and ask questions. Even the wise men, as they came into town, had to say, now where exactly do we go? So here's a question for you. Am I reading, studying, and listening to wise men? Number four, here's a little known part. They didn't always get it right. Then Herod called the Magi secretly, and he found out from them the exact time the star appeared. Notice he calls them secretly. He didn't want them to be tipped off. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, oh, go and search for the child. As soon as you find him, report it to me so I can go and worship him. Yeah. I don't know about you, but I don't know if I'm sure at some point the wise men found out that all the babies were killed in that area. I'm sure that they had to say, they believed a liar, they went to a liar. Let me ask a question for you. Do you expect to never make a mistake? Or do you expect perfection from others? By the way, if you're a person who not only expects yourself to be perfect, but you expect other people to be perfect, people don't want to be around you. I say that as nicely. No, I didn't say nicely. If you're always the one correcting everyone, and you feel like it's your job. I had a guy one time tell me, I'm the white blood cell of the church. I'm like, what? He's like, yeah, I'm the one who corrects everyone. I would love you to go somewhere else to church if that's you. Don't have it all together. Nobody does. Your pastor doesn't. Did you know that? I mean, David has a MySpace page, and we're just praying for you. don't, and nobody does. No, so we need to help each other, and we need to not expect to be perfect ourselves. Some of us, when we fail, we give up because we say, well, I didn't do it perfectly. And God's not waiting for you to be. Have you ever read the Bible? Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, bunch of liars. Bunch of liars. But they were the foundation of the Jewish religion and the foundation of who Jesus was. David, you know, David, who Jesus' lineage, totally blew it. God used him. So don't expect perfection from you. Be honest about it. Confess it to God. Now, I'm not saying to pursue wrong things either. Don't get me wrong. Like, well, Eric said we're going to mess up, so let's just go for it. We're going to get drunk after church. Let's all go, right? Okay? That's not what I'm talking about, okay? That's the other side of the coin. But the truth is, when you do fail, and you do mess up, and you blow it, what do? You confess it, you make it right, and you move forward. When other people mess up, when they confess it, and make it right, let them move forward. I love this next quote. Success is stumbling from failure to failure with no loss of enthusiasm. Number five, probably the most important point in this whole message. They took time to worship. After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them. And by the way, this was a change from what was happening. Went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the, listen to the next word, say it out loud. On coming to the house. Wait a second, I thought he was in a stable. Oh, you're messing me up here. When coming to the house, they saw the baby. They saw the child. I'm really sorry, people. With their mother Mary. And they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures, whether it was 3 people or whether it was 30 people or a whole entourage, we don't know, and presented him with gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. By the way, I did a whole sermon just on those 3 things a few years ago. Let me ask you this question. Do you take time to worship God? Some of you are Christians. You've given your life to Christ. You even read the Bible, but you don't really take time to worship. You don't take time to get still. When you sing songs, you're saying words, but you're not really applying the words. These songs should be prayers. Worship is not just songs, but worship is one way. I mean, singing is one way to worship. Everything you do is an act of worship. When you point it towards God, you say, God, I need you, that's an act of worship. When you say, God, help me, that's an act of worship. God, I need you. When you sing these songs as prayers, it's an act of worship. By the way, sometimes you sing the songs and you say, gosh, I'm doing that, God, I believe that. Other times you're singing the song and going, okay, I need to believe that, God, but you know, I'm not quite there yet. I mean, I'm singing holiness, holiness is what I long for, and the truth is, not quite. I mean, maybe a little, but like not full holiness. Like I still like speeding, so I don't want that. Right? Don't take that part. I mean, not that much holiness. I want to keep driving the way I drive, you know. But Lord, I need you. You take time to worship. So God's word, paying attention, seeking wisdom, making mistakes, taking time to worship, and finally, this seems so trite, but it's true, they were flexible. What do I mean by that? I don't know if you've seen the chart. The chart looks like this. This is you right now. This is your plan, right? It's a straight line. You see that? And then, right? And then they have the one for God. Read the Bible. You think you're undergoing something? I don't know about you, but I'm reading the Bible, the book of Exodus. You're in the book of Exodus. You're in Exodus 14. The people for years and years and years and years and years are promised they're going to get out of Egypt, go to the promised land. They're headed to the promised land. First thing, water. What do we do? Be still. Okay, that's going well. Pharaoh's coming at us. Be still. God, your plan is not my plan. When you make a trip, you take the easiest route, hopefully. You wouldn't take a difficult route on purpose, right? Listen to what happens here. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country. Listen to those next 3 words. By another route. See, we don't even pay attention to those 3 words when we're reading this passage. They did not have Google Maps. They did not have GPS. They did not even have good maps necessarily. So they would have taken the easiest way there, but now they're going to go home by another route. I'm sure the other route was more difficult. I don't know about your life, but sometimes I say to God, God, I'd like it to be easy. Why is it hard? And God says, you're just going to have to trust me. Are you flexible when God changes? Listen to that next word, your plans. Are you flexible when God changes your plans? He's not surprised, by the way. When the Red Sea was closed, God didn't say, I didn't think of everything. Do you realize that God could have told Joseph first that Mary was pregnant? Wouldn't that have been easier? Anybody else think that would have been easier? Like, God, could you tell Joseph first? Oh, by the way, Mary, you're pregnant. Instead of Mary coming and going, by the way, Joseph, I'm pregnant. What? He didn't believe her, by the way. He thought she was lying. I don't know about you, but if I'm God, I'm thinking, you know, it'd be a lot easier if I told Joseph first. I mean, God, you got this thing out of order. No, he doesn't. And what you're dealing with now, whatever it is, whatever the hurt and the heartache and the struggle, God is not surprised by it. And in the middle of that, God can give you another route. It may not be an easy route, but he will be with you, and he will walk with you, and he will walk you through it. God has a mission for you. Love God and love people is a simple version, but in the middle of that, are you and I going to learn what it means to trust God? And how can I accomplish the mission he has for me? He had a mission for the wise men, and he has a mission that's just as important for you in your life. And he will use you to be a blessing on this earth every day that you're here. If you'll let him. If you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, we don't do a formal invitation where we come forward during a song, but I'll be here after the service. And you might say, Eric, I want to give my life to Christ. I think we've had 3 or 4 already sign up and talk to me about getting baptized. You might want to get baptized, take that next step of faith after the new year. You can do that today. Maybe you're here and you just need prayer. I'd be glad to pray with you after the service. I don't know about you, but my mission is not always easy, but yet I know God's always with me. Let's go to the Lord in prayer today. Father, thank you for the mission you've given each of us. I know there's some here that are totally discouraged. They're just feeling overwhelmed by life, and things have not gone the way they think they should go. Lord, I understand. And yet, Lord, you said in the middle of all that we can trust you, so we trust you even when you take us another route. Father, I pray for that one here today that's discouraged, they would know your presence. Father, for that one who doesn't know you, that today would be the day they surrender their lives to you. Father, for that one that's watching online right now, that they might surrender that part that they don't want to surrender to you. Lord, thank you for this time. Lord, I pray as we give financially that you would bless each dollar that's given to be used here and around the world to help people to find their mission, to find their way home to you. Thank you, Lord, for this time.